Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2021. I'd like to ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Please note that apologies have been received from Megan Gallagher and Murdo Fraser is attending in as substitute for her. And as this is Murdo's first appearance at the committee and accordingly as our first item this morning, I would like to invite him to declare any interest relevant to the work of this committee. Murdo.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. In relation to the work of the committee, there are two interests that may be relevant to the committee's work and today's session. I am a member of the Law Society of Scotland, although not currently practicing. And secondly, I derive some income from two rental properties that I have an interest in, although neither of these are let on a short-term basis. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Murdo. Our second item this morning is consideration of whether to take items 6, 7, and 8 in private. Item 6 will be an opportunity for members to consider the contents of its report on short-term lets. Item 7 will be a chance for the committee to agree its approach on the scrutiny of non-domestic rates coronavirus Scotland bill. And item 8 will be an opportunity for the committee to give further consideration of its approach of the MPF4. Do members agree to take items 6, 7, and 8 in private? And that looks like agreement. So thank you very much for that. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's work on short-term lets. This is the committee's final evidence session on these regulations. After taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary, the committee will debate the motions and recommending approval of the regulations. But before I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to the committee, I'd like to also welcome Fergus Ewing. I'd also, welcome to the committee Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. Andrew Mott, Head of Housing Markets Unit, and Rachel Nicholson, who's the lawyer in the Housing and Elections Branch of the Legal Directorate in the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today. And I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Well, thanks very much, convener, and I'm really grateful for the opportunity to speak to the two motions seeking approval for the instruments. With the committee's permission, I intend to speak to both instruments together. We're committed to ensuring that local authorities have appropriate regulatory powers to balance the needs and concerns of their communities with wider economic and tourism benefits of short-term lets, and we've consulted extensively to take this forward. In 2019, we consulted on the broad principles of our regulatory framework, and this showed broad support for some form of regulation. That formed the basis for the proposals to implement a licensing scheme and control areas announced in January 2020. In September 2020, we launched a second consultation on detailed proposals for legislation, which was then laid at the Scottish Parliament in December 2020. As a committee, you will be aware the licensing order was withdrawn in February 2021 following concerns raised by some members and tourism stakeholders. In response, we established a working group made up of a wide range of stakeholders to explore and resolve these concerns. The working group did make helpful suggestions for changes to legislation, which was reflected in the draft that we published for the third consultation in June. Further pragmatic and significant changes were made to the licensing order following careful consideration of responses received to our third consultation, and these changes were set out in my letter to the committee in October and included the removal of over-provision powers and stronger guidance on fees. I know that short-term lets bring many benefits to hosts, visitors and the Scottish economy. They're an important source of flexible and responsive accommodation for tourists and workers. However, they have also caused issues for local communities that need to be addressed. At the heart of the licensing scheme are basic safety standards, which will help to protect guests, hosts, neighbours and communities across Scotland. Many hosts will already be following these standards as a matter of compliance with existing law or best practice. We don't consider them to be onerous. Where there are other problems such as noise, nuisance, littering, antisocial behaviour, the loss of residential housing stock and adverse impact on local communities, the licensing scheme together with the control area legislation give local authorities the powers to address these. Issues arise in both rural and urban areas of Scotland, and we expect local authorities to use their powers to do no more or less than is necessary to tackle them. And I totally understand the impact that COVID-19 has had on the tourism sector, which is why the government has supported the tourism and hospitality sector through the pandemic, not least through an extension of the 100% NDR relief for all retail, leisure and hospitality premises for 2021-22. However, we need to put this legislation in place now so that councils can get their licensing schemes ready. Many local residents and communities are keen to see progress on this issue, and today provides the opportunity for us to make sure that happens. Turning to control areas, the control area regulations were laid in December 2020, approved by the Scottish Parliament and came into force on the 1st of April 2021. Control areas will help manage high concentrations of secondary letting where it affects the availability of residential housing or the character of a neighbourhood, and they will help to restrict or prevent short-term lets in places or types of building where it's not considered appropriate. And this will help local authorities ensure that homes are used to best effect in their areas. The City of Edinburgh Council and Highland Council are both moving forward with proposals to designate control areas, and the control area amendment regulations align the definition of short-term let for control area purposes with that in the licensing order. And finally, we'll continue to work with and listen to stakeholders. We'll shortly reconvene the stakeholder working group to finalise the guidance on the licensing scheme and prepare for implementation. And we'll work with local authorities to review the levels of short-term let activity in hotspot areas in summer 2023. And this review will identify whether any further measures are required to control numbers and check we've avoided any unintended consequences. I believe our proposals take a robust but proportionate approach through the regulation of short-term lets and are right for Scottish circumstances. I therefore ask the committee to support the motions today and look forward to any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And it was so great to hear you clearly set out the purpose of the proposed licensing system for lets. I'm going to start with some questions and then we'll just work around the committee members who've indicated they would like to ask questions. So my first question is that the committee has heard that there is possibly insufficient data about short-term lets in Scotland to support the introduction of a licensing system. And I'd be interested to hear what data did you have access to when developing the proposed licensing system?
I think, first of all, the evidence set out in our BRIA suggests that the market appears to be recovering towards pre-COVID-19 levels of activity, although we obviously have to keep an eye on that. And we used the 2019 data established in the Scottish Government's 2019 research as a baseline for our BRIA. The BRIA also sets out trends in existing data sources, which include the non-domestic rate role and data provided from Airbnb. Both of these sources show a period of rapid growth in the short-term let sector over the last decade. Baseline activity, though, is challenging, not least because properties can appear multiple times on the same or different platforms, and the licensing scheme will help to clarify the levels of activity locally and nationally, allowing a more comprehensive picture of short-term let activity across Scotland to be mapped for the first time. And I think that will be helpful. Clearly, the number of short-term lets vary from area to area. There are some areas where there is quite a concentration, particularly obviously Edinburgh, some rural parts of Scotland, particularly the Highlands as well, where rates can be well above 10%. But I think we will get more comprehensive data, as I said, through the data gathered through the licensing scheme.
Thank you very much for that response. So last week, we heard from panellists who felt strongly that the over-provision regulations is really required if the legislation is going to have the intended effect and actually empower local authorities. If the control areas that are outlined as they are don't deliver, are you prepared to revisit the over-provisioning aspect of the regulation? And if so, when?
So, well, as I said in my opening remarks, we do believe that the package of measures in the licensing scheme plus the short-term let control areas powers for local authorities will be enough. We think that those will give local authorities the powers that they need to address concerns. And as I set out, Edinburgh and Highland are already looking at, will have moved forward with the proposals for control areas, and I think other local authorities may also do so. However, I also flagged that we would be having a review in the summer of 2023, and that would give us an option then to look at whether or not more controls are required. We'll be able to take stock of where we are. And if it shows that those powers are not sufficient to address areas of concern, then that would be an opportunity to look at that. It would also be an opportunity to look at anything that's not working with the licensing scheme or any concerns from the tourism sector. So that summer 2023 would be the opportune moment to have a look at all of these things.
Thank you very much for providing that clarity and the kind of potential time frame from that. So that's my questions, and I'm going to now move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to the panel as well. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to the Evidence Committee has heard around a different approach to this, specifically around the regulation through a registration scheme rather than the licensing scheme that's been put forward. So in your consideration of this, why has that suggestion of having a register scheme rather than a licensing scheme not been taken forward?
Thanks for your question. We did consider registration as part of the 2019 consultation, and we've also considered the proposals from the ASSC made earlier this year for registered accommodation to be exempt from the licensing scheme. We don't believe that registration offers the same protections to guests, to neighbours and local communities as licensing does. To be robust and effective, a registration scheme would really need to meet much of the same requirements as the licensing scheme would do. We understand that the policy intention of the proposals for registration would be to ensure compliance with broadly the same mandatory conditions set out in the licensing scheme. However, we didn't really see a draft registration scheme, and it's not clear how it would be enforced. But I think that the main point actually that I would want to make is that I don't think registration would include any provision for a fit and proper person test or additional conditions to be attached to the registration. And these are important components of the licensing scheme, which a parallel registration scheme would potentially undermine. So that fit and proper test, I think, is important, not least from a safety point of view. And I think, as the committee heard some of the concerns from Police Scotland around any criminal activity, I think that fit and proper test will be important. So it was given full consideration, but we believe that the licensing scheme as proposed is proportionate. It's not onerous, but it does provide a level of protection for those using short-term lets.
Thank you for that. And one of the key aspects, which I think the Cabinet Secretary in your opening statement accepted, was most of the concerns which have been raised have been about a certain few areas in the country, honeypots, for want of a better word, basically around tourism. And witnesses have argued that the approach the government's taken has been disproportionate to introduce this Scotland-wide licensing system. So can I ask, what assessment has now taken place of the control areas which would have put in place, and why is this Scotland-wide scheme being seen as necessary when this is very much seen as a issue around key pressured tourism areas?
So I think the licensing scheme seeks to ensure that every short-term let across Scotland meets basic safety standards, and that should be the same whether that's in Edinburgh, whether it's in the rural Highlands. I think that it's important that, you know, for urban and rural areas and for businesses large and small, there needs to be a level playing field. During the consultation and ongoing correspondence, we've heard from residents in many places across Scotland, including Glasgow, Ayr, Applecross in the Highlands, Loch Lomond, the Trossachs National Park, Isle of Harris, North Berwick, St Andrews and West Linton, among others. And they've highlighted a range of concerns about short-term lets, including the impact on local housing supply, noise, antisocial behaviours. I don't think these are just urban issues. I think also delivering national consistency on safety standards is important, and allowing and enabling local authorities to use the additional powers beyond the core elements that they see fit to meet the needs of local communities. And we've committed, as I said earlier, to work with local authorities to review the levels of short-term let activity in those hotspot areas in the summer of 2023 to see whether any further measures are required. In terms of the control area, obviously they came into power or into place in April, and Edinburgh have consulted widely on that, and they would then, if they wanted to move forward, would need ministerial approval to make the whole of Edinburgh a control area. Ireland have moved forward with just Badenoch and Strathspey because they see that as an area of particular concern. So these are really powers that local authorities can use if they want to and see it as a proportionate response to local issues, but they're not required to do so. So I think that's the right balance. It gives local authorities the ability to use them if they so wish. And as I said, the control areas would require ministerial approval as well.
Okay, thanks for that. And just finally, would you accept that actually the national safety standards could have been achieved through a registration scheme, not necessarily a licensing scheme?
Well, I think, as I set out earlier, I think the licensing scheme gives the additional protections. It makes sure, for example, that the fit and proper person test is there. And I think, as was heard by the committee at the last evidence session, a lot of support for this among local authorities to be able to use the additional powers that have been given to them if they so wish. There's no requirement beyond the core element of the licensing scheme, but local authorities, I think, welcome the fact that they would have these additional powers to deal with things like noise, antisocial behaviour, littering, appropriate to their areas. I think a licensing scheme does that in a way that I'm not convinced a registration scheme would have.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Miles. And I believe Mark Griffin would like to come in with a supplementary on that question, and then we'll be going to Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Camilla. Yep, just to continue on that line of question from Miles Briggs, Cabinet Secretary, you said at the start in your opening statement that you wanted to give local authorities powers to address concerns. Now, there clearly are concerns in some local authority areas, but we haven't heard the same level of concerns in others. I just wondered whether there was any consideration given to devolving the powers completely to local authorities to give them this discretion on whether to introduce a licensing scheme or not, addressing their own local circumstances.
Well, I think this is the right balance. I think local authorities in the main are supportive. I think the response from local authorities in the main is supportive. I also think that actually beyond the core measures in the licensing scheme, it is about devolving power to local authorities to either take those additional powers forward on antisocial behaviour, on littering, on noise, to meet concerns in their local area or not. And they obviously should do that in a proportionate way. The short-term control areas, similarly, there's no requirement for local authorities to use those powers, but it's very clear to me that local authorities that want to and see that as a way of addressing issues within their area will do so. And we've already, as I mentioned earlier, had two local authorities bringing forward proposals for control areas. So I think it strikes the right balance. We want those basic safety standards to apply everywhere, so they should apply everywhere. But beyond that, the local authorities have a lot of discretion on whether they would use those additional powers.
And just one other small question, just to ask the Cabinet Secretary if any consideration had been given to a pilot project in particular local authority areas which have concerns.
I think we've, because of the extensive consultation that has taken place, and you know the work that has gone on around the provisions here, I think moving forward across Scotland with substantial changes that have been made, I think is the right approach. We want everyone using short-term lets across Scotland to have the same basic protections, the same assurances, and to make sure that there's a level playing field for hosts as well. It isn't fair that some clearly have been putting in place all of the measures that they should put in place, but others may not have, and that's not fair to those hosts who have done the right thing. So I think creating that level playing field across Scotland will be important as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. So we'll now go to questions from a question from Murdo Fraser with a supplementary from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I've got a couple of questions I want to ask around the issue of cost to local authorities, and then separately cost to business. The committee's had a lot of evidence from local authorities and also from the sector about the potential costs, and a lot of criticism of the figures in the business and regulatory impact assessment, which assessed the estimated cost to be £200 to £400 per property. But the evidence the committee has heard suggests it could be much higher than that. SOLAR, who are the Society of Local Authority Lawyers Administrators in Scotland, have said that these could be more likely to be £1,500 to £2,000, which would be a major burden both on councils and small business. We've also seen individual councils raise concerns. In my area, you know, Perth and Kinross Council have raised this issue. Fife councils say in their submission that the fees set out are incredibly low, and the section of the BREA should be more realistic and not give a false hope to applicants of low fees. So can I start by asking, how were the figures in the BREA calculated? How robust are they? And in the event it turns out that the local authorities who've submitted evidence to the committee are correct, how is the balance to be made up? Will they be expected to raise the fees on a full cost recovery basis, or will the Scottish Government step in and provide additional financial assistance to them?
Well, thanks for your questions. I'll start with the issue of local authority resources, if that's okay. And a total of 23 local authorities responded to our 2020 consultation. Only three of those responses expressed the opinion that the Scottish Government should provide any sort of grant or loan funding to support the establishment of the licensing scheme. 11 local authorities responded to the 2021 consultation, and two local authorities highlighted concerns about resourcing. Outside of the consultations, there's been no formal requests so far for additional funding that have been received, and we have engaged extensively with local authorities and other stakeholders to finalise this legislation, which we think is efficient and effective. In terms of the fees calculation, an updated BREA was published on the 23rd of November, and the updated BREA was informed by consultation responses and other information provided to us, including concerns raised by stakeholders. Part of the process of updating the BREA, the Scottish Government officials and economists worked through all of the public information and information made available to us from stakeholders. We engaged with Airbnb, the ASSC, the SBBA and local authorities in particular about their concerns around the levels of fee and the impact on the tourism sector, and that all informed the final version of the BREA. And the costs set out in our BREA reflect the Scottish Government's best estimates of average costs and fees across Scotland across a range of scenarios. The actual fees to be charged will, of course, be determined by local authorities following the Scottish Government guidance, and the average cost will depend on local conditions, The assumptions in our fee model have been informed by discussions with local authority licensing officials. I think, importantly, the guidance, well, first of all, it should only be cost recovery, so they shouldn't go beyond that. But also, there should be a proportionate risk-based inspection, and that will be set out in guidance. And I think perhaps that's where there has been some difference of agreement, disagreement that essentially worries that every single property will be inspected numerous times over in the course of the licensing scheme. And yet what we've said is that there should be a proportionate risk-based inspection, and that could be based on a number of factors. But that in itself should keep the cost down, because it would be the inspection level itself that would drive any fee costs up. So hopefully that will be assuring to the sector, and when they see the guidance, that will be set out very, very clearly around the level of inspection that we would expect local authorities to carry out. And as I say, that should be risk-based and not onerous.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the response. I mean, it's helpful you've confirmed there will be full cost recovery, but I mean, there's still a very wide discrepancy between the figures that have been quoted in the BRIA and the figures being quoted, for example, by Solar. So can you explain the reason for that gap? Because, you know, you would think that those working in local government would have a closer understanding of the likely costs than Scottish Government officials would have.
So I think it is around that proportionate risk-based inspection. If you were to do an analysis of fees that wasn't based on a risk-based inspection, then of course, if you were inspecting every property every year, then of course the fee level would be higher. But we're not asking local authorities to do that. We don't think that would be proportionate. So we're asking them, and the guidance will set out the detail of how we would ask them to do this, to set up a risk-based inspection system, which would mean that, for example, if there had been any concerns about particular properties, or if the concerns about a fit and proper person, or a range, there would be a range of issues that could be brought to the local authorities' attention, and therefore that would determine which properties may be inspected more than others. So, I mean, there are the local authorities understand, I think, risk and proportionate based approaches, and this is what we would be asking them to do, and that of course will help to keep the costs down considerably, and I think that's where the difference will probably lie in the figures at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Convener, I've got a slightly different question on the costs of compliance, but I don't know if you want to bring Paul McLennan in at this point. I think he had a follow-up on my earlier question.
Yes, Paul, Paul, would you like to come in now with your supplementary?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee. Just to refer to my register of interest, I'm a serving councillor in East Lothian Council at the moment, Convener. To expand on the question that Murdo Fraser asked, and it's really just, I mean, I think the indications we got, Cabinet Secretary, was that the average fee set out was £436. Some of the feedback we've got from some tourist body surveys appear to demonstrate that many operators would leave the industry as a result of the licensing scheme. Is that something you would share with the additional cost? And also, I think the majority of operators already comply with the safety standards. And again, just your thoughts on that and your views on that.
Well, many do, and therefore I think making sure all do creates that level playing field, and I think that is important. I mean, I've set out the reasons I think that there perhaps has been a differing approaches to the level of fees, and I think the guidance will be very important here. I should also say that it should be proportionate to the size of the business. So those large operators with large party houses, should pay more than a kind of one room in a host house. Clearly, there should be a proportionate to ability to pay and size of business, and that again will be set out in the guidance. So I think all of that will mean that the fee should not be onerous. As I said earlier, it should only be cost recovery. So all of that taken together, I think, will mean that the fees should be manageable and proportionate to the size of the business as well.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. And Murdo, did you want to come back in?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Another question on cost, but from a slightly different angle, because it's not, of course, just the cost of the licence fee that has to be considered, is the compliance costs to businesses. I accept the point the Cabinet Secretary has made, some businesses will already comply, but for others, the BREEA in June calculated compliance costs could be £963. Operators have suggested that the actual average cost could be three times that, as much as £3,000. And I think the difficulty with this is you then start to add up to a cumulative set of costs here, which start to act as a real deterrent to people to participate in the tourist sector. And what's being proposed here doesn't just impact on short-term lets, because the way it's been framed, it impacts also on small bed and breakfast properties. So, for example, in the area I represent, a town like Pitlochry, which is very heavily dependent upon tourism as the source of income, you'll have a broad range of small accommodation providers, owner-run bed and breakfasts, which are being caught by this, and they see this simply as another form of taxation, because they struggle to see what benefit they get out of this new set of regulations, and yet they'll be hit with substantial annual costs in order to comply. So why have bed and breakfast been brought under the ambit of this when potentially it could make some of them make the decision not to proceed and just drop out of the industry altogether?
So the cost of compliance, at the heart of these are a set of basic safety standards, and I think we should hopefully all agree that all premises should have that set of basic safety standards. Now, as you said, some are already doing that, but if some are not, then they should be, because that creates that level playing field and ensures the safety of those using those properties, which is really at the heart of these measures. Murdo Fraser then went on to talk about bed and breakfast. So, as I said, the set of mandatory standards, which will help protect the safety of guests, should apply, I think, to all the whole self-catering sector. Many hosts across bed and breakfast will already be following these standards as a matter of compliance with existing law or best practice, so we don't consider them to be onerous. The B&Bs have been included from the beginning, and I think one of the important reasons for that if they weren't included, then I think you could have a number of potential relabeling of premises to B&Bs to avoid licensing. I think that is a concern that has been expressed during the consultation. And I think trying to differentiate B&Bs from other types of provision would have been very, very difficult as well in terms of defining a B&B compared to other types of provision. So all in all, we took the view to leave B&Bs within the scope of the licensing proposals, and the point about the relabeling, I think, is one that would have been a considerable concern should they have been excluded.
Thank you. Just one follow-up question to that, Convener, if I may. The Cabinet Secretary might be aware, bed and breakfast owners have had a really tough time over the past couple of years because of a number of restrictions that's impacted on tourism. They're also at the moment seeing substantial increases in costs. For example, energy costs, which are a major part of the cost base of B&Bs, are increasing substantially. So, I've certainly seen in the area I represent a lot of people going out of the B&B sector. What were successful B&Bs being turned back into private houses, and that has a negative impact because it narrows the choice of accommodation for visitors, who are so important to the economy, particularly in rural Scotland. I'm just wondering why it wasn't possible in drafting this to exclude B&Bs where the owners lived on the premises. I mean, that would seem to me to be an obvious cut-off point to say there's a clear distinction between something that's available for short-term let as a discrete set of accommodation, as opposed to a B&B traditionally where the owners live actually in the same building, but provide you know, other services such as, you know, providing breakfast or, you know, teas, coffees, etc. Was it not possible to draft the legislation in that way?
No, I think that would have been difficult to have had a specific definition that would have excluded some but not others. And I think the danger of kind of redefining, some operators could have redefined in order to avoid licensing, as I said earlier. But the point about this not being onerous is important. You know, when it comes to the level of fee, you know, a small B&B operating, the fee should be proportionate to the level and size of the business. I was struck by, it was Andrew Mitchell who gave evidence from the City of Edinburgh Council. And one of the points he made, he said, first of all, the inclusion of traditional B&Bs makes sense. If they're not included, a loophole would be created, which would allow every short-term let to provide a small breakfast and claim they were exempt from licensing laws. So they said, we strongly support the closure of that loophole by including traditional bed and breakfast in the definition. But he went on to say, and this is the important bit, as I said, each local authority will deploy licensing systems that reflect what it sees as the risk. For example, if somebody is living in a property, which is more likely to be the case for traditional B&Bs, they might be subject to a less onerous inspection regime with fewer requirements, and therefore the fee would be proportionate to that. So I don't think, you know, traditional B&Bs have, you know, should not be concerned about this at all. I think there's been a lot of things said that may have worried them. What I would like to say is we want them to continue. They're an important part of the tourism sector, and there is nothing onerous or to be concerned about in these proposals. I think local authorities will take a sensible approach to the way they deploy this licensing scheme that will make sure that traditional B&Bs you know, are continue to be supported, and there will be nothing onerous in it for them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Murdo. And we'll now move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to continue the line of questioning Murdo Fraser has with regards to unintended consequences, because industry witnesses have told the committee that licensing of short-term lets could lead to many owners leaving the industry, potentially costing Scottish tourism tens of millions of pounds of lost revenue annually. So I just wondered how the Cabinet Secretary would respond to those claims.
Well, I don't think that will be the case. I mean, over the last few months, the sector has been quite buoyant with the level of staycations that there has been. Now, we always need to keep an eye on that, because obviously, we're in a, you know, a tricky situation at the moment. But I think if you look at over the last few months, the self-catering sector has been quite buoyant. I think in terms of the sector going forward, I think with the guidance that I talked about earlier and the way this will work in practice, sector really doesn't have anything to be concerned about, and I don't think, therefore, the concerns about people leaving en masse are what would happen. I don't believe that is what would happen. Plus, I think it's important to note we've made considerable changes to the proposals responding to concerns from the sector. You know, from the removal of the minimum EPC requirements through to the removal of over-provision, simplifying many of the aspects that they had raised concerns about. So we have listened, and we've tried to make this as straightforward as possible. And I think once it is in operation, I think operators and hosts will realise that actually any concerns they had did not come to pass.
Thank you for that. And in terms of disproportionate impact, which we've already touched upon, what assessments be made of those who, for example, rent out a property for the month of August, for example, in Edinburgh during the Edinburgh Festival, or during summer months when we have peak tourism in rural areas? Because I think there was real concern expressed that there is going to be a disproportionate impact on small and rural businesses as a percentage of their income around this scheme. So would you share those concerns, and how do you think they can be overcome, given the sector is often very different in different parts of the country at different times of the year?
So in terms of the point, and I think this is the point Miles Briggs is getting at, in terms of facilitating maybe home sharing and bed breakfast, we want to facilitate responsible home sharing, and licensing authorities will have wide discretion in granting temporary exemptions or temporary licenses within the powers of the 1982 Act and the licensing order, and will develop the guidance on granting temporary exemptions and temporary licensing with licensing authorities. And that would cover things like short-term temporary periods of letting, like during the festival, etc. I don't know if Andrew maybe wants to say a little bit more about that in terms of that short period of letting.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, so as the Cabinet Secretary was saying, there are powers for temporary exemptions and temporary licences which could facilitate somebody wanting to rent a room for a short period or whatever. As the Cabinet Secretary was saying, we'll produce guidance on that, and it is up to each local authority to determine their own temporary exemption policy, and they've got quite a wide range of powers there. So some local authorities may want to have these policies and others may not, and they can set certain limitations. So for example, you could say that we will grant short temporary exemptions of, I don't know, 3 weeks for this festival for home sharing, but we won't grant it for secondary letting. So there's quite a wide range of powers to facilitate that kind of peak pressure from events.
Thank you for that. And how many of those would you expect to be made available? You'll know the pressures of Edinburgh during the festival, and for a lot of people, the fact that they do utilise a spare bedroom in their homes to rent that out. I've received emails from constituents who actively say that they need that extra money to make ends meet, with the additional costs of energy coming as well. It's something which people are acutely aware of, having the potential to bring in additional income for them. So if this is going to be councils deciding, how many would you expect each council to provide, or is there a cap on that expected as well?
No, there wouldn't be, and it would really be down to the local authority to decide that. They know the area better than we do. They know for example, Edinburgh City Council will know the requirements during the festival period. It would be for them to decide the appropriate response, and I'm sure they would do that in a sensible way. I mean, they want to make sure there's enough accommodation for people coming to things like the festival and fringe. I'm sure they would operate the system in a way that would be able to meet that demand.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Miles. And we'll now move on to a question from Paul McCullen.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose it's just a little bit of expansion on what can be around about monitoring the impact of the licensing scheme. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that was going to be reviewed in 23. I'm just wondering, is there a format to that as yet, or what will the format of the review look like in 2023? I think that's a really important point that you raised earlier on, reviewing that. But I just wondered what that would actually look like.
We haven't decided on the format per se, but I would want it to be pretty open. I would want it to take stock from stakeholders, from local residents and communities, from local authorities. So really the same groups that have been involved in the three consultations so far. We would want to revisit those stakeholders and find out how it's working for them, both as providers and hosts, and also as users of short-term lets and those who are impacted by short-term lets. So we want to take that in the round and be pretty open about it.
Yeah, just to add on to that, Cabinet Secretary, in terms of that, I mean, and this maybe in terms of process, maybe through the clerks as well, would that come back? Would that be come back to the committee, or how would Scottish Government take that review forward in terms of transparency around about how that, you know, what came out of that review?
Yeah, I'm very happy to engage with the committee around that, and we can perhaps follow up with some thoughts in near the time about how that might work. But yeah, we want to be open and transparent about that process, and the committee's involvement in that would be very welcome.
Okay. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. And now I'd like to bring Eleanor Whittam in with some questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. And before I ask my questions, I'll just refer everyone to my register of interest. I am still a serving councillor, Enni Stearshire. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Nicola Robison, who was from Police Scotland, told this committee on the 14th of December that Police Scotland were broadly supportive of the licensing scheme and welcomed the inclusion of the fit and proper person check to ensure safeguarding of guests and neighbours, which you've already alluded to. And she told this committee about criminal exploitation arising from a lack of regulation. Is the risk of criminal activity an issue recognised by yourself, Cabinet Secretary, and how would the licensing scheme help to combat this? Thank you.
Yes, I mean it is an issue that it's a small part of the sector. Clearly, the sector in the main are very law abiding and provide good premises and well. Safe premises for people to use. So I would want to just put that on the record. But without a doubt, there is some criminality, and I think the evidence given by Nicola Robison from Police Scotland shows that the importance of the fit and proper person test being part of the licensing scheme is critical, because they would then be able to flag any issues and concerns around someone not being a fit and proper person that then could be used by the local authority in terms of the licensing scheme and whether or not to grant a license. So I think yes, it's a small element, but an element that we can't ignore.
Thank you very much for that. We've also heard that tourism stakeholders have raised concerns about the application process being a de facto ban, and they alluded to things that are happening over in Dublin. There's uncertainty arising from the licence and renewal process stymieing their business. How would you respond to those concerns, and are they well founded?
No, I don't think they're well founded. So let me say a couple of things about that. That where a licensing authority fails to determine an application on time, then the application is deemed granted for a period of 1 year. So a licensing authority, if you like, can't kick a license application into the long grass, if that was the concern. And existing hosts and operators apply before the 1st of April 2023 can continue to operate whilst their licence application is processed. So I don't accept the issue of a de facto ban at all. And I think because the processes are probably quite different in Dublin than they are here in regard to that, that application being deemed granted for a period of 1 year. So there's nothing to be gained by delaying applications, and I think local authorities would want to be very swift and efficient in getting the licensing applications dealt with.
Thank you. And finally from me, can you reassure us that the licensing authorities can't use the licensing scheme as a means of revenue generation through fees accepted to cover their own costs? And can you confirm that you will provide guidance? We've already heard quite a lot about that. Two licensing authorities on parameters for setting the fees, and indeed on other issues that require local flexibility. As you've already said, local authorities know their communities best.
Yeah, well, the principle is cost recovery only, that they can't go beyond that. But the guidance will set out in more detail around you know, what we think you know, is important around that to make sure that local authorities are following that. We want this to be proportionate. We don't want it to be onerous, and the guidance will be very clear on that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you, Eleanor, for those questions. And now we're going to go to Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I wonder if I could just ask a couple of questions on the issue about it deals with broader antisocial behaviour, again, if I may, please. We heard some people giving evidence that we already have powers to deal with antisocial behaviours. And we also heard, on the other hand, I think from the Edinburgh City Council official, that the existing powers dealing with antisocial behaviour don't really fit this sector. They're more about long-term behaviours and how we deal with that kind of behaviour long-term. So there was a balance of view, Cabinet Secretary, on this issue. Where do you see it, and why do you think the licensing scheme gives us a better solution to deal with that than perhaps a registration scheme might do?
I think first of all, we expect all relevant authorities to use all of the powers available to them to deal with antisocial behaviour. But we do think that existing antisocial behaviour legislation is better suited to handling issues with longer term residents, where follow up and enforcement is more straightforward. And I'm sure Willie Coffey, as I have had cases along these lines, it does take some time to get through some of the legislation and support people to do that. The licensing scheme gives local authorities and Police Scotland transparency in knowing who the owners of short-term lets are and ensuring that they're fit and proper to hold a license, which will also include whether or not there have been issues of antisocial behaviour. So I think you know, this will be the local authorities will have the power to be able to use this in an appropriate way that can meet the needs of their local area. They could also put in sort of proactive conditions. So if a big holiday house has been annoying the neighbours because of people drinking kind of all day and all night, they could put as one of the conditions that alcohol can't be consumed after a certain time, or they could do that in a proactive way rather than having to deal with the consequences of antisocial behaviour. So it really is about giving local authorities the powers to be able to do that. And we've included licensing authorities may wish to include a condition requiring the licence holder to manage their premises in a way to prevent antisocial behaviour as reasonably practical, as I've just kind of given an example of. And we've included a template additional condition relating to antisocial behaviour in the draft guidance published in June. And we expect local authorities only to impose proportionate additional conditions where they are necessary. But if a property has been causing concern in that respect, then that may be something the local authority would want to consider.
Thank you for that. I wonder, could you clarify also, or your legal colleague, Jonah, if a person was refused a licence or lost their licence, if a scheme comes into play, to being that is, does it become a criminal offence for them to continue to operate a short-term let? I know of some cases where complaints have been raised with Edinburgh City about antisocial behaviour, but there is nothing that prevents the operator from continuing to operate under those circumstances. So is there a legal advantage to the licensing scheme that would assist us if that problem arose?
Could I ask Rachel to maybe come in on that and maybe just outline some of the kind of the penalties for offences? That might be helpful.
Thank you.
Absolutely, yes. Good morning, committee. Yes, yeah, so that's correct. In terms of bringing short-term lets into the scope of the 1982 powers, in Section 7 of that Act sets out that it is an offence to operate a short-term let without a licence. So yes, if you were refused a licence or if you lost your licence that you'd already been granted for whatever reason, then that would, if you continue to operate, then that would be a statutory criminal offence. In terms of penalties, there are level 4 penalties on the standard scale there. That's in respect of continuing to operate without a licence, and there's also the option for a sheriff to convict and imprison a person, as I understand it.
May I just briefly follow up on that with you? Is it similarly an offence under a registration scheme to continue to operate if complaints of that nature, that antisocial nature, have been raised and proven to be correct? Is that also an offence to continue to operate?
So the registration scheme, as I understand it, as it's been proposed by some stakeholders, it would be under the terms of the Development of Tourism Act 1969. And in terms of that compliance or not with the registration, there is a power to fine, I believe, but it would be a lower fine. As I think other witnesses have pointed out, it is a self-regulatory scheme. There isn't an oversight body or independent oversight of compliance or not with the registration scheme.
Okay, thank you for that, Rachel. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. And I'd like to bring in Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've discussed the desirability of a licensing scheme, and one of the reasons that you've set out is that this would enable the fit and proper person test to be incorporated so that the police concerns could be addressed. And that's a very fair point. I mean, is it your suggestion that that fit and proper test can't be part of a registration scheme?
Well, I think that's the basket of measures that are in the licensing scheme that come together, that, as Rachel has just outlined, a self-regulatory registration scheme would not have the same requirements upon people to comply. And I think the powers that we're giving to local authorities go beyond the core elements of the licensing scheme are also important. So I think the licensing scheme strikes the right balance of making sure that where there is a practice that is either not adhering to basic safety standards or potential criminal behaviour, people not behaving in the way that they should, that at that extreme end, that there is a proportionate response that can be deployed that I don't believe would be able to be done in the same way under a self-regulatory registration scheme. So I think all in all, this is a proportionate and balanced approach. I know that the elements of the sector think otherwise, and we've tried to work with them to compromise around some of their concerns, and we have done on many of their concerns that they've raised. But I think where we've landed now is a proportionate and balanced approach.
I mean, I'm interested in that reply because I did get the impression from your evidence, Cabinet Secretary, earlier that your argument was that a registration scheme, a mandatory registration scheme, because that's what is being proposed, and a statutory scheme could be incorporated, of course, could not enable the fit and proper person test to be brought in. But I'm looking at the Scottish Government website here, Landlord Registration Statutory Guidance for Local Authorities 2017, paragraph 4, the fit and proper test. Local authorities must refuse an application for registration if not satisfied that the applicant is a fit and proper person to let houses. So actually, the fit and proper person test already applies to the existing landlord registration, and rightly so. And like Mr. Fraser, I let on a long-term basis of property, and I can recall the form, which I believe requires you to submit if you've had any problems with the police, for example. So far as the fit and proper is concerned, it does seem to me that that is already part of the registration scheme, which applies to long lets And there's absolutely no reason, therefore, why it shouldn't be applied to a registration scheme for short lets, is there?
Well, as I said, I think you have to see this as a basket of measures that are proportionate to respond to the very real issues that have been raised by communities. I mean, I guess you could turn that on its head and say, if all of these things are things that the sector wants, then why are they opposing the licensing scheme? What is it about the licensing scheme that they're so opposed to if the registration scheme is going to do exactly the same thing? So I would suggest that the registration scheme wasn't going to do exactly the same thing, and that we require the ability of the local authority to have the powers to refuse a licence if someone is not operating in a way that's safe or in a way that is responsible, and indeed to be able to use the additional powers that they have to deal with some very, very real issues that local residents and communities have raised. I believe a licence scheme does that in a way that a registration scheme would not.
Well, the fundamental difference between a licensing scheme and a notification scheme is very, very simple, that Scotland's local authorities will have the power to refuse a licence. That means the business will be terminated. That is not part of a notification scheme, and therefore the difference is inherent and draconian. And I mean, there are 17,794 self-catering properties in Scotland, contributing £867 million to the economy and 23,979 full-time equivalent jobs. I think the Airbnb figures estimate around about 30,000 properties. All of these tens of thousands of properties now will have some fear that their business may be confiscated, may be terminated. And that's the difference between the two. But I did want just to, since the Cabinet Secretary has raised antisocial behaviour and safety standards, just probe her answers and colleagues' questions, helpful questioning, on a couple of aspects about these specifically. Because in relation to fire and electricity standards, the law already exists on all these things. And indeed, when she wrote to the committee on the 7th of October, the Cabinet Secretary made it absolutely clear that these regulations do not enhance or change the existing law. It already applies to all properties, quite rightly so. In fact, she said, we are reviewing the fire and safety electricity requirements to ensure they do not go further than the existing law. Now, what I wanted to ask this, I mean, if these rules don't enhance or increase the standards, then the only way that the protection that she referred to would be conferred by these regulations could possibly apply would be if every single property were inspected regularly. But in reading the BRIA, the revised BRIA, as I did yesterday, it makes it absolutely clear that mandatory inspections are by no means required. It specifically says that that is not a requirement. So I don't quite see how, if there will be no mandatory inspections, and I'm not arguing that there should be, Cabinet Secretary, but if there are no mandatory inspections and the law remains exactly the same as it was before, in what way can she justify the assertion that these regulations, if passed, would provide any additional protection?
So maybe to take Fergus Ewing's first point about the ability to refuse a licence, he's right in one sense that absolutely, you know, the vast majority of the sector are law-abiding, good providers, and provide a very important element of the tourism economy. Absolutely agree with that. But is it not right that those who don't abide by the law and are not providing safe spaces for people to stay, should they not be refused a licence? Why should they be able to operate when the person down the road is doing everything they can and to make sure their short-term let is a safe place? Why should the person down the road who's not doing that not have consequences to that? So the ability to refuse a licence, I think, is important. And that is an important difference between the licensing and registration scheme. So in many ways, I think Fergus kind of makes the point for me that actually that is the whole point, that if someone is not complying, that's unfair and not a level playing field, and therefore it should have their licence refused on that basis. But those who are abiding have nothing to fear from the licensing system. In terms of the fire safety guidance, fire safety guidance, as Fergus will know, for existing premises with sleeping accommodation was published back in June 2018. Part 3 of the Fire Scotland 2005 Act, along with the Fire Safety Scotland regulations, set out the fire safety duties in respect of the majority of non-domestic premises in Scotland. Obviously, not all short-term lets are businesses, so it's important, I think, that we have a mandatory condition of a licence that gives all the protection to all anybody using any type of short-term let. And the licensing order puts some basic requirements in place for all short-term lets in terms of safety measures. I don't know if Andrew or Rachel might want to come in on that. Maybe Rachel from the legal point of view.
Yes, thank you, Cab Sec. I wonder before I do that, may I just make a quick clarification on the evidence I gave earlier in response to Mr. Coffey's question, if that's possible. Just to clarify, and my apologies for this, that in regards to penalties, was there a failure to comply with a continuation of operating without a licence, that the penalty specifically in regards to short-term lets would be a level four fine on the standards scale and not imprisonment. My apologies for giving some incorrect information in regards to the legislation there. In respect of the question regarding safety conditions, I think I would just clarify that whilst the statutory duties do already exist, the purpose of putting them into the requirements of a licence is to ensure that compliance with them makes it a requirement to first of all obtain a licence and thereafter to remain licensed. And anything within those mandatory conditions that would not be in line with current requirements on non-domestic properties in regard to the Fire Safety Act nothing would contradict anything that was already in place in regards to the 2005 Act fire safety requirements.
Well, thank you for those answers. I mean, I just make the point that these duties, as Rachel Nicholson has just confirmed, apply to everybody anyway. And obviously, all of us want to see the law applied and observed by everybody. And I make also the point that neither hotels nor long-term lets are subject to a licensing requirement. So if consistency was the sine qua non, the essential element, it ain't there, because various types of premises don't have to follow these requirements of a licensing a requirement, which carries with it the risk that people can lose their business, which is particularly coming out of a pandemic, a pretty serious threat hanging over them like a sword of Damocles over the next few years. But I wanted to turn to antisocial behaviour because, contrary to what seems to have been said before, there is surely, Cabinet Secretary, specific legislation dealing with antisocial behaviour in holiday lets, namely through the antisocial behaviour notice brackets, houses used for holiday purposes, close brackets, Scotland Order 2011. And that legislation exists. The local authorities have the power to deal with antisocial behaviour as it occurs in short lets. And, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, why is it necessary then to bring forward a licensing requirement when local authorities already have the powers that are required to deal with any such behaviour should it occur in short letting properties?
Well, as I said earlier on, and I recognise what Fergus Ewing has said, but I think in looking at all of the issues in detail, one of the things I spoke about earlier on was the proactive ability of local authorities to put proactive requirements in place to prevent antisocial behaviour. And it's really bringing all of that into the one place so that local authorities, in looking at short-term lets, they can use some of the existing powers if they so wish, but they can also look at all of these issues through the lens of the licensing scheme. And as I gave an example around hours of drinking, for example, if a holiday let has become a place where it is causing significant concern to neighbours that they could put proactive requirements and conditions in place. Fergus Ewing, you know, said about the concern, and I absolutely recognise that in the pandemic has been had an impact on the tourism sector. I think there are certainly signals over the last few months that the self-catering sector, the short-term let sector in Scotland has been recovering pretty well with the burgeoning of staycations, but we've got to keep an eye on that, obviously. And I think the government has recognised the impact of the pandemic on the tourism sector, not least with the 100% NDR relief for hospitality premises. And of course, that will continue at 50% for the next year, as announced in the budget, plus all of the supports given to businesses, the small business bonus. So I think it's not a fair accusation to say that the government hasn't supported local businesses, including those in the hospitality sector. This is not an onerous set of requirements, and I think once it is up and running, the sector will see that. A lot has been said that, of course, may concern people if they were to hear that and to think that they're going to have to pay thousands of pounds for a licence. They will not. It will be a proportionate-based scheme. Small operators will pay less than big operators, and local authorities will be given strong guidance to make sure that it is based on a risk-based inspection regime that is not onerous and should not drive up costs. So all I can say is to try to reassure the sector of those things, and I'll continue to try to do that over the next few months as we bring these measures forward.
Well, you know, I hear what Cabinet Secretary says and understand her sincerity behind these thoughts. I think it's fair to say that particularly larger lets in the self-catering sector have hardly had any of COVID rules quite correctly. So they really have had a tough time over the past wee while, and the uncertainty remains for the whole sector. So my point really is that the registration would, as the sector incidentally proposed, and they deny that there was consultation in 2019, and they also maintain that they did propose a fit and proper person test, incidentally, and I'd just like to place that on record. But what we heard in evidence 2 weeks ago, Cabinet Secretary, and I was able to attend that meeting myself, was that the whole sector is united in favour of a registration scheme, the whole short-let sector. And also, they have support from the Federation of Small Business, Scottish Land and Estates, Scottish Agri-Tourism, the NFU, as well as all of the short letting organisations. And I would point out that several of these bodies actually left the working group because they felt that it was, not to mince my words, a sham, and it wasn't addressing their concerns in any way. And recently, the Cabinet Secretary will know that the Highland Council passed, after a vote, their view in favour of registration, not licensing. And this seems to me to be the final point. So the last question I would just like to ask the Cabinet Secretary, and I'm grateful, Convener, for the opportunity to do this today, because it's essential for my constituency and for the Highlands and Islands in particular, is this, that where we have such a draconian power of the state via local authorities to terminate businesses, is it not a very serious failing of the regulations that there are no set clear rules or criteria governing how this crucial decision should be taken? I've searched in vain amongst the regulations to see what criteria there are that local authorities must follow. There are none whatsoever. And when we hear from evidence, as we did last week, from someone speaking on behalf of chief housing officers of local authorities, that, and I'm quoting here, we simply now need to select those businesses that can no longer operate. Surely that must strike fear into businesses that are being told that some of them must be selected for closure before the regulations have even come in, by a senior figure speaking on behalf, apparently, of the local authority family. So I just put it to you, Cabinet Secretary, and I'll leave it with you. There must be concerns about judicial review on the grounds of irrationality and arbitrariness and the lack of a clear set of rules, but that it's not really too late for the Scottish Government to say that they look again at a registration scheme which would deal with the fit and proper person, as the registration scheme does for letting longer term residential properties. It's not too late for any government to reconsider, as we've seen with one or two others, such as the named person. And the public generally appreciate when we accept that we've got it wrong. Surely, Cabinet Secretary, the licensing scheme is just too draconian. It's too unfair. There are no set of rules, and there will now be a period of division and difficulty and anxiety amongst tens of thousands of law-abiding small businesses in Scotland that have done nothing to deserve this threat which is now being placed over them.
I don't accept that. I don't accept it's draconian. I don't accept it's irrational, and I don't accept it's arbitrary. I think it's proportionate, and I think along with the guidance that will require local authorities to act in a proportionate way. And Fergus Ewing will know, as a former minister, that whenever government brings in any change, there will be quite often opposition to that change. There will be, concerns about impact that doesn't always necessarily equate to the reality of the situation. And what I've tried to set out today is the reality of the situation, that none of this is intended to close any business other than those that are operating out with the law and are not operating safe premises. I've set out that we want to make sure that the costs are proportionate and kept proportionate to the size of the business. Fergus, you mentioned Highland Council. Highland Council were supportive of these measures when they responded to the consultation. I can't speak for them in terms of the vote they then took, but their response to the consultation was fully supportive of the measures. So that's something for Highland Council to deal with. The working group, I do recognise that stakeholders left the working group. Perhaps at that point they felt that they didn't support a licensing scheme, and that was the direction of travel, that was their decision. However, can I say that I've had some very productive discussions with the key organisations that Fergus Ewing has referred to. Now, there's not going to be a meeting of minds on the issue of the licensing scheme, but most have said that they want to get back round the table in a working group type environment to talk about the implementation of the detail. And I think that's a responsible attitude to take, and I very much look forward to working with them around making sure that the detail and the issues that Fergus raised are discussed, and that the guidance is clear, and that we don't have, local authorities, I think, they don't want to take a disproportionate response either. But let's make sure the guidance is very strong to give further assurance to the sector. So. And I just end on this. We've talked about the registration scheme versus the licensing scheme. And I come back to this fundamental point. If an operator is putting people potentially at risk because they are not operating in a manner they should, or there's criminality, or there's antisocial behaviour that makes people's lives around them a misery, then surely in those circumstances, the local authority would be correct in considering refusing a licence or removing a licence. But you're talking about those very small cases where those would arise, not with the law-abiding good providers who will go about their business with this licensing scheme in place in the same way as they have before it was in place. And we will continue to support them in the sector because we know they provide an important part to the Scottish economy. So I will continue to try and reassure the sector about this licensing scheme that they have nothing to fear from it.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Fergus, for your questions. I believe we have come to the end of the questions, so I'd just like to say thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and to Andrew Mott and Rachel Nicholson for bringing forward that thorough evidence. And we're going to move on to the fourth item. The fourth item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M02265, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 licensing of short-term lets order 2022 be approved. And I'd like to invite Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Just formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. And I would like to invite members who would like to speak to the motion to put an R in the chat. I'm going to see we have Miles Briggs, Eleanor Whittam, Mark Griffin. So, Miles, would you like to start?
Thank you, Convener. And I think throughout the passage of this legislation and the regulations, it has been concerning, and I've been very much taken by those who are industry experts and those who actually are at the front line of their businesses being impacted, that they do feel there is real unintended consequences to these regulations, and the potential to negatively impact on a very fragile sector. Given the pandemic, given the impact that has had, I think that's something we should be very mindful of. And my own personal view is that I don't believe Scottish ministers have actually considered the alternatives in good faith. I've been taken by what's been presented to the committee in terms of a registration scheme, for example, meeting the outcomes which ministers have set out rather than a licensing scheme. So I am concerned that these regulations go too far. One of the key points of that, and in closing, is a letter which the industry has sent to the First Minister. That includes the Association of Scotland Self-Caterers, the Professional Association of Self-Caterers UK, Scottish Agritourism, Scotland's Best B&Bs, the Scottish Bed and Breakfast Association, and Scotland Land and Estates. And they specifically say that, make no mistake, this onerous and costly licensing scheme will cause many traditional self-caterers and B&B operators to leave the sector, hitting the supply chain and local economies in the process, and reducing the diversity of accommodation available and Scotland's capacity to welcome visitors to our country. With all that in mind, and given the impact the pandemic has had, I don't believe we should be moving these regulations, and so I'd ask that the committee vote against them. Thank you.
Thank you, Miles. And now, Eleanor.
Thank you, Convener. It's clear to me that local authorities must balance the needs and concerns of the communities that they serve with the wider tourism sector and local short-term let owners. While short-term lets are a flexible option for individuals, we must balance this with the overall safety, the loss of residential housing stock, the antisocial behaviour that we can see, the potential criminal activity that occurs, whilst also creating a level playing field across the sector. And on balance, I do not feel a licensing scheme would be overly onerous, and I move that we agree the motion as laid down by the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you.
Thank you, Eleanor. And now I'll call on Mark Griffin, followed by Paul McClellan, and then Fergus Ewing.
Thanks, Kavina. And I'll be brief. Just wanted to say at the outset that actually I've been quite heavily influenced by the evidence given, particularly by Police Scotland, at our last evidence session on the need to introduce a degree of licensing. I think it's fair to say that I would have preferred to see perhaps a pilot project introduced at the early stage to see how it could be operated and give assurance to the sector, or potentially local discretion to deliver to local authorities to give them the ability to decide if it was suitable for their area in consultation with their own communities and Police Scotland. But in the absence of any alternate proposals, we know that committee is case or take it or leave it, then I would support the proposals in the knowledge that there will be a review in 2023, and as the Cabinet Secretary has set out, that industry want to get back around the table to seriously discuss the implementation. Thanks, Mayor.
Thank you, Mark. And now Paul, Fergus, and then Willie Coffey.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think it's safe to say that we've all listened to the sector extensively over a period of time, both through the committee and out with. I think there are a few key factors, I think, for myself. I think with the local authority background, I think that it's just a case of cost recovery is incredibly important, because I think you need to take the views of the cost in terms of where we are in terms of the pandemic and recovering from that. I think, and we've taken evidence at committee around about the costs, and I'm convinced that the costs have been mentioned. I think it was £464 as mentioned the average cost in the BRIA, and that would be proportionally to the size of the business. That works out at £9 per week now, and I think that's the key thing. I think for me, like Mark Griffin, I was was persuaded a lot by the evidence from Police Scotland about looking and about fit and responsible people, and I think that's important. The key thing, I think, and this is again maybe addressing the point that Fergus, you made, responsible operators have nothing to fear from this at all, absolutely nothing to fear. And the vast majority of operators do operate extensively, but there are issues around about people who don't, and we need to make sure we drive up the standards of the sector. So again, I'm convinced, like Mark Griffin, in terms of the review in 2023, that's why I asked that question. I'm convinced by what the Cabinet Secretary said, that we will come back in 2023 and this committee will have a look at that. So I will be supporting the proposals as the Cabinet Secretary has put forward.
Thank you, Paul. And Fergus, would you like to come in now?
Yes, thank you, Convener. And I do absolutely agree with the sentiments that the Cabinet Secretary has expressed here about the need to provide as far as we can a system that protects the public. I think getting to the nub of things, if I may, Convener, because I've made some remarks already and I want to repeat them. If it were the case that we needed licensing simply in order because of the police evidence, then the regulations should really have said that the license will be granted unless there are good reasons not to. And one of those good reasons would have been that the applicant was not a fit and proper person on the basis of the police information. But that's not what we're presented with here, Convener. I did make the point to the Cabinet Secretary that there are no criteria, there are no rules, there is nothing to fetter the discretion of our local authorities in their decision as to whether to grant or refuse a licence. I think everyone would agree that if you've got a hoodlum, a money launderer, a drug dealer that is laundering money through property, that there must be means of dealing with that. I think there actually are, and that he shouldn't be given a license to conduct such a business or other businesses. But that's not what the regulations say. The regulations do not delimit the discretion to that particular issue. And moreover, I think I've already proven, Convener, by reading out from the Scottish Government own website that the fit and proper person test does apply to a registration scheme. It applies to me as a landlord, and rightly so. I'm glad it does apply. So the idea that we need a licensing scheme to deal with the police concern seems to me not to have been made out. The second point I wanted to make was this, that I did earlier allude to concerns that precisely because these rules have not been specified and local authorities have unfettered discretion, paving the way for 31 different varieties of decision making, incidentally. That means that the position of those businesses, many of whom have operated for decades, is that they may face the unilateral withdrawal and confiscation of their business by the decision of a local authority, which they cannot challenge on the basis of any clear rules. Now, whilst no legal expert, Convener, I am aware of cases where the Scottish Government has failed because of breach of Article 1 in the First Protocol of the European Convention of Human Rights, namely the provision which says that every natural person has the right to protection of their own possessions, except in the interest of public policy. If there had been a clear public policy interest expressed in these regulations, then that might have enabled the government to say that they had acted reasonably. But because there is none, it does appear to me that, although as a non-expert, there's a risk of arbitrariness. And the Wensbury test, which I believe applies, it seems to me to be at serious risk of being at issue. And I don't make that argument enthusiastically or lightly, but because I'm genuinely concerned about this. And I would also point out, Convener, that as the Cabinet Secretary is aware, the Association of Scottish Self-Caterers have already shared opinion that they've had from an eminent firm of solicitors in Scotland. And I'm informed, although I haven't seen the evidence myself, that three other equally eminent firms of solicitors in Scotland have also opined on this issue. I stress, I haven't seen whether their view is that there's a prima facie breach and judicial review may therefore be successful. I just put it to you as a matter of common sense, and to the members of the committee, that if there's a system where somebody's property can be taken away, somebody's business can be terminated, then surely there should be a very clear set of rules governing in what circumstances that can happen. Because it's all very well to say that, oh, well, there's the fears of that have been raised are alarmist or scaremongering or whatever. But because there is no set of clear rules in these regulations, what are people to think? And moreover, Convener, if there is the possibility a license is withdrawn and the licensing system takes several years to operate, then between the application of the license and the determination, there will be a period of long uncertainty. What happens to bookings during that period and cancellations? And what happens to the business if the license is refused? None of this has, I'm afraid, been answered. Convener, there's many other arguments I could put, but I think I've probably said enough to indicate that I'm not a fan of these regulations. The last thing I would say to the Cabinet Secretary is it's never too late to look again at this. I hope that she will, as she has promised, engage with the sector before this comes to plenary session, in the event that it's passed today, as I suspect it will be, in order to look further at the very real concerns of the sector and the very real and serious and sincere alternative proposals which operate in Europe, which are favoured by the EU, incidentally, including the exemplar in
You'll
Portugal.
You'll wind up now, Mr. Ewing, please.
Yes, and my last sub-clause, and which I think, believe, should provide a clear way forward.
Thank you. And we'll now move to Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Convener. I think the evidence we heard, particularly from Police Scotland, was pretty compelling, and I think members would do well to listen to that advice that we got during that session, and also from the councils too that we heard from last week. We need to be able to deal effectively with some of the issues that are impacting on local people, and there should be no fear whatsoever, in my view, on operators in complying with a licensing scheme. It will also help us to establish, to drive up and maintain standards across the sector, so that responsible operators are not disadvantaged by those who might prefer to operate in the absence of any regulation whatsoever. So I support the proposal, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Willie Coffey. And I'll just so thank you everyone for your contributions. And I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for your thorough evidence in setting out Scottish Government's intentions with this legislation so clearly. Short-term lets have been with us for about 10 years, and while they do provide an important contribution to the tourism sector, as well as an income stream for those operating them, it's taken us that time to see the impacts they have on our neighbours and communities. Unregulated, short-term lets have inadvertently begun to shape and negatively impact our rural and urban communities. We've heard how local people or public sector workers, teachers, doctors, and even people who work in the tourism sector struggle to find affordable housing in areas where short-term lets proliferate. And in the case of the licensing regulations, we've learned of a range of problems, from what was once a small cottage being transformed through extensions into a party house, bringing with it noise and lack of contribution to the local services, to some levels, as we've heard today, of criminality, calling for the need for the fit and proper part of the proper person part of the licensing scheme. And we also heard last week from the challenges faced by Police Scotland and local authorities, as other members have indicated. We also heard from Elsa Rayburn that this is big business, and the data shows that almost 40% of owners in Scotland have more than three properties, while 8% have more than 100 properties being run as short-term lets. We heard about the concerns of the burden the licensing system will place on short-term lets providers, but I believe that the cost will be proportionate, as we've heard through evidence, and in terms of the process, I trust our local authorities to come up with one that is efficient and easy to use both for the licensing application and the renewal. These short-term lets licensing and control area regulations are two pieces of legislation that will work together to help us to ensure we have communities where local people who want to continue to live there, or public service workers who are coming to live in the community to provide much needed services, can find a home. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for indicating that we will have the opportunity in 2023 to review how these regulations are working and to revisit the possibility of over-provision regulations. At a time when we recognise the importance of maintaining rural populations, focusing on placemaking and creating 20-minute neighbourhoods, you must use legislation to design a Scotland where people can live safely and be close to where they work. These SSIs are part of other measures we need to take to support our communities and address the urgent need to provide local, affordable, adequate and accessible housing. And I'd like to invite Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Thank you. Just firstly on your point, Convener, yes. And I think that that review point is important. It will give us the opportunity to look at whether there's more that needs to be done, but also the operation of the licensing system. And as I said earlier, I'm happy to involve the committee in that. If I could just respond to a couple of the points made. I mean, Miles Briggs will be well aware, as a Lothian member, of the concerns of his constituents about short-term lets. And of course, the position of the City of Edinburgh Council through Andrew Mitchell's evidence was very, very supportive of these measures to help to, as a basket of measures, deal with some of those concerns. Eleanor Whittam said about the balancing of those of concerns with stakeholders and communities, and that's absolutely right. And we've tried to do that through the proposals, and we've done a lot of made a lot of changes, brought a lot of amendments in response to listening to many of those concerns. Excuse me, Mark Griffin. Yeah, I think the evidence from Police Scotland was a very important piece of evidence, and I also recognise his point about the review in 2023. Paul McClellan on cost recovery and the fact that responsible operators have nothing to fear from this is absolutely the case. And I would just want to end on responding to a couple of the points Fergus Ewing made. I won't respond to them all because it would take too long, and I won't repeat all I've said. But obviously, when the government, as he will know, brings forward legislation, then it will have gone through a series of legal tests, as he will know. And I would just say that some of the points that he made, I don't think recognises that actually a lot of this is based around the 1982 Act, which applications are approved unless there are good reasons for refusal. And some of the reasons are set out in the 1982 Act, paragraph 5 of Schedule 1 of the 1982 Act, to be precise. And the legal position is that the scheme is, of course, compliant with the right to possessions clause. And, you know, introducing regulation in a proportionate way that has been subject to careful scrutiny, I think, is an important point as well. And it's being introduced by way of existing well-used statutory framework, which is well understood by local authorities. And I don't think local authorities will be setting out to try and close local businesses down. What possible motivation would they have to do so, to do that within their area? What I do think is they will use this in a proportionate way that deals with the very real issues that local communities are raising, but also supports those good providers who are law-abiding, who abide by the rules, and create a level playing field to make sure that those who don't behaviours can be addressed through this licensing scheme. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm now going to move forward with the motion. The question is that motion S6M02265 in the name of Shona Robson be approved. Are we all agreed? No. Okay, great. So we're going to use a voting system in the chat function of the online broadcasting. And I think you and our clerk is going to start us off there. So if you can put your eyes on the chat, that would be great. And we're just going to take our time with this online process. Okay, so we've got in the chat, please, could those in favour press Y when asked by the convener? So for all those in favour of the motion, please put the Y. Thank you. And all against the motion? Thank you. And any abstentions. Okay, so we're just going to get the results. Oh, I haven't. Yes. So the results are 5-4, that's Eleanor Whittam, Willie Coffey, Paul McClellan, Mark Griffin and Ariane Burgess, against 2, Miles Briggs and Murdo Fraser, and there were no abstentions. We will confirm those results in the committee's report. The fifth item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M02264 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Town and Country Planning Short-Term Let's Control Areas Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022 be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Formally moved, convener.
Thank you. And I'd like to see indications if any members wish to speak to this. No indication for anyone to speak. The question is that motion S6M02264 in the name of Shona Robson be approved. Are we all agreed? Okay. So it looks like we're not all agreed. Can I just say, can I just have indications of shakes of heads, or are we all agreed? Okay, so we're going to do the voting in the chat again. So everyone in favour of the motion, please put a Y in the chat. And everyone against approval of the motion. And any abstentions? Okay, no abstentions. Okay, so let's just pull those results together. So we have 5-4, Eleanor Whittam, Willie Coffey, Paul McClellan, Mark Griffin, and Ariane Burgess, and 2 against, Miles Briggs and Murdo Fraser. And we will put the results and the outcome of the debate in our committee's report. As agreed earlier in the morning, we will consider items 6, 7, and 8 in private. And I now thank the Cabinet Secretary and their officials and close the public part of the meeting, and we will move into private.